Hello and welcome to this webcast. We're looking at SOLIDWORKS Visualize today, and your presenter is Richard Early. So I'll hand straight over to you, Rich.
Thank you very much, Charlie. Right, excellent. So this lesson is looking at SOLIDWORKS Visualize, our new rendering package, and the idea is going to slot in nicely with our lesson one series, so the start of a brand new training course. At the moment, the training course is still in development. It's going to be announced a bit more at the start of next month, a bit more about it. We've run it internally last week with great success, and this is kind of the first bit from that. So I started off here with a lovely picture of his motorbike. It's actually a guy called Daniel Simon. He's a concept artist. He's worked at VWC, Lamborghini, Bugatti. Also does for films as well. So he did the Tron Legacy bikes. Oblivion did the bubble ship in there, and I think he's working with Marvel at the moment, with Captain America. And he's one of the people who actually kind of demoed and trialed Visualize before it was launched for SOLIDWORKS. So I've got a few kind of renders of this quality, which was nice to look at. Right, so the agenda, what we're looking at today. So first we'll look at what is SOLIDWORKS Visualize, first of all. I will talk quickly about hardware, what hardware is needed to run it. Look, introduction to the courses, actually two on Visualize itself, so look at different two. And that's looking at the standard and also professional version of the software. We'll quickly go through the interface as well. It's a little bit non-SOLIDWORKS-y, let me say. We'll talk about some of the options in there. And we'll look at getting started finally into the lesson and get more course content covered through there. So first of all, what is Visualize? What is the new package? So it's a physically accurate ray tracing based rendering software developed on the NVIDIA iRay technology. It was formerly known as bunk speed, and there's three levels of that. There's a shot, a pro and a drive, and it was kind of aimed at the automotive industry for it, and now it's available as Visualize standard itself. And this is gratis, it's running for free for professional and premium subscriptions. So if you are entitled for this, you can download it now. It's not currently in sync with the releases from SOLIDWORKS themselves for service packs. It's a download currently on the customer portal, but as of 2017, it will join the release cycle and go up. It's currently not part of it, simply because they're trying to bring out things quicker, more and more changes quicker to the software, as it's relatively new, so that's why. And the idea at the moment as well, I've been asked about this quite a lot, is to run this side-by-side with PhotoView. So it's still a PhotoView 360, and have this as well, so run side-by-side. I foresee that happening for a couple of years at least now. You can also get a professional version as well, which we'll kind of talk about, and that kind of gives you options for your animations, and also a few additional options as well with your renders. So we'll kind of talk about the two of them. First of all, though, a bit of jargon busting. So it's a physically accurate rendering tool. What is that, and what does that mean? So really, it's as close to real light lighting conditions as we can get with rendering. Many other engines, PhotoView included, take shortcuts and assumptions based on your algorithm to build up the speed, make it a little bit quicker for you. And then those biased renders are slightly different from this. It may take a little bit longer, therefore, to set up something in Visualize, but you get a much better result for it. And these sort of biased renders also produce sort of noise and artifacts as well. It's difficult to possible to eliminate with a render. And really, PhotoView has a lot more controls hidden away from us to use. That's just trying to make it look kind of nice and easy and quick to use for you guys instead. Hardware. Hardware is definitely a thing to talk about with Visualize. As I've mentioned, it's using NVIDIA iRay and CUDA technology. Therefore, NVIDIA cards are definitely a plus for it. Majority of renderers use either your CPU or your GPU, your processor or your graphics card. This one actually can use both, but you do have to have an NVIDIA graphics card for it. They're significantly faster with mid to high-end NVIDIA Quadro workstations. Go for Quadro rather than GeForce. GeForce are your gaming cards, whereas Quadro are your CAD ones. So if you're using it on a SOLIDWORKS machine, we definitely recommend a Quadro rather than a GeForce version of the GPU. The number of CUDA cores dictates the speed, increases what you expect. New generations do significantly more work per CUDA core and the older ones. We are going to produce a blog sometime based upon this. My colleague Alan Sweetnam is doing some testing at the moment on different specs to see what sort of speeds he can get for them. So this will be blogged at some point, just to show. And really, we found even like the newer generation, they're so much faster. We've actually had a few new laptops online from Dell just to try this out, and they're a bit faster than the older graphics cards at times. That being said, you don't have to go for a high-end one, but if you are doing a lot of renders a lot of the time, perhaps it would be worth investing in one machine with high spec. Somebody can then perhaps queue everything with a professional onto that machine and go from there. So I said it's two courses. At the moment, this is all may change. It's correct as we're speaking now on the 1st of June. But the two courses will be sort of Visualize Standard and also Visualize Professional. Both be a one-day course, and we have to attend the standard before we can go to a professional course. And for that reason, they'll be run together. So do a professional, you know, attend one, then the other. And we'll look at scheduling these next month or so. So we'll be popping up. I believe we'll be sending an email letting you know about them as well. Right, so standard versus pro. We have these two different versions. What do you get with Visualize Standard? So this is the free one you have with SOLIDWORKS Professional and Premium. In this, you can import CAD data live from SOLIDWORKS. You can import appearances, decals, remote projection only, but working with the other ones at the moment, and also scenes directly from the SOLIDWORKS files themselves. And you can live link this between them, so changing one will bring them through as well. You do static renders of unlimited resolution. Actually, that's a little bit of a lie. There's a cap, I think, about 500,000 pixels. But realistically, you're not going to come across that. If you imagine you're doing a 300 dpi render, so for print quality, about 40 meters or so in width for it, so I presume no one's going to produce a render that large. That is the size at the moment it can produce. You can also save the image if you want before it's completed. So if you're sitting there perhaps with a tight deadline, you simply, once you produce a render, once you're happy with the quality, simply save out and go from there. Also depth of field as well, just do some camera tricks. I also got preset camera filters as well, with no real post-processing options in the standard version. And I also can do HDR lighting as well, so some environmental lighting, imagine from photo view, so that kind of sphere going around your item. And also output all the images from my cameras as one sort of batch production. Professional then, what's the difference? Well, it's exactly the same, the standards, plus keyframe animation, automatic component rotation, linear and turntable animation, photometric lights, so point spots, anything else you want. So running environment, additional lighting as well. Configurations, this is perhaps a poorly named option. It really should be display states, those familiar with SOLIDWORKS display states. We basically have multiple versions, multiple colors in there, so you can jump between the configurations or display states if you prefer for it. And also render queuing, so it's quite a big one, quite a useful one. So perhaps you're setting up your renders about 5 o'clock, you leave at 5:30. What you can do if you want is put the send to a queue, have them running on all overnight, come in the next day, and be done for you. So render queuing, quite a useful one. Other things as well, outputs, so we can do VR, we can also do panoramic, so move around them, and also do several different passes as well for post-processing and Photoshop. So some of this panoramic and VR options are actually examples if you want to look on our website. So actually kind of go around the item, spin it around, or something actually be inside like an interior and look around and see what's happening. So here's an image here produced with standard. You can see it's just a exhibition stand here. You can see the lighting going around. If I compare that with Pro, I've got a few extra options. So a bit more fire, try and highlight here. We have a little bit more happening up here in the lights themselves. You have some bloom effect going on with more light actually going from the emitted materials onto the scene. And definitely a difference between them. So if I compare them side by side here, you have standard professional. It's a professional there, so it looks a lot better with the lighting conditions. You can see if it was much more like a glow, if you like, from the light source themselves producing it. Interface, hopefully you've messed about with it, you've had a little play of the software, but it's a little bit different from SOLIDWORKS. At the moment, over here in the top, as of any Windows program, we have File, Edit, View, so the main menu at the top. With the main viewport itself in the center, my model's viewed. We have a main toolbar atop here with various commands. We have a library on the far right, so it would be appearances, environments, or anything else you want to apply. And right at the bottom down here, we have statistics themselves. So as you see what's happening with the model itself. A few little things as well. Actually, the software itself, manipulating models, it's not quite like SOLIDWORKS with rotation and also selection at times. So example rotate is Alt and left mouse button. Zoom is Alt and right mouse button. Middle mouse and Alt is your pan. Alt and the scroll wheel is adjust for camera lens or focal length. Control shift right mouse button is look at or zoom to fit. So really the key thing to remember is the Alt key. It's your friend at the moment for it. We will look at bringing it a bit more into SOLIDWORKS controls in a way, so we'll look at trying to bring that in. I know it's being set perhaps to happen in 2017. At the moment, all you do is remember to use the Alt key. And otherwise, we'll jump in and get started. So the course focuses quite a lot on this model here. Is actually a trike modeled up by a couple of our interns this year. And we'll look at is importing the SOLIDWORKS geometry itself, changing the environment, applying appearances, copying and pasting those appearances, modifying them so it changes to be a certain colour, and producing a final render itself. Excellent, so let's jump into Visualize now. Now the interface may be slightly different from the one you have at work. I also do have Pro here, there's a few changes sometimes with them, however, so I won't point anything which you may or may not have. So I'll start myself at a brand new project. I'll look at importing the SOLIDWORKS geometry and bring it in. This new project itself, it loads up to blank, so a blank space, or nothing in at the moment. To import your geometry, simply go to File at the top, go to Import, and choose Models and Parts. And what I'll do, I'll jump straight to the SOLIDWORKS assembly itself and bring it in. Import settings, there's some quite good import settings here. So things like apply auto size, and perhaps you've got a really large model, bring it to a small scene so it automatically size it for you. Monitor file, a very useful tick box, this will actually live sync with your SOLIDWORKS geometry. So if something changed, it'll say actually you need to rebuild, re-import, and geometry then update and visualize. Part grouping as well, how you want to be brought in. So I might choose automatic, I could choose perhaps by appearances, by layers and other such options as well. I'll bring my SOLIDWORKS basic appearances for now. I won't bother to bring in the environments or decals, however, so I'll just bring those ones off for now. Hit OK, and I'll bring it in. Files it can bring in, we can bring in basically a lot of different file types. It doesn't have to just be SOLIDWORKS geometry. So obviously you've got your IGES as your steps, of course brings in from Creo, from Edge, here as well. We can bring lots of different file types if needs be into Visualize. So here we have it. Here's a model. At the moment it's floating a bit, and this can sometimes occur when bringing your model in. In fact, my colleague Finn had just had a support call on this earlier today. So if you do find a situation, simply head to your library up here, go to the model, choose the trike. There's either a very useful snap to floor button, or if needs be, simply position it by a certain value, in our case obviously 000, to apply it to the floor. As you can see there, it's applied. Little things to note about the interface. So there's three different view modes, these three here. One on the far left is a preview mode, just give you a kind of quick preview. One in the centre is something called fast mode, and what it would do is go up to 100 passes in rendering for you. And one on the right is accurate mode, so that's for high end rendering. So where do we see these options? If I quickly change it to be fast, and I'll quickly rotate to reset or zoom in, zoom out. And what you see down here, live, is a pass number going up. And as this goes up to 100, it will then stop. So that's for links it can go up and specify. For ease of use, just on this webcast, I'll go back to preview for now. But it could change your various options if needed. Otherwise, let's look at applying different environments we'll get majority of our lighting for this model. So I go over to my libraries, and here I can choose my appearances, cameras, environments, models, or anything else we want to bring in. For us, we'll go to environments. Lots of ones here already downloaded. What I'm after here is a high contrast, this one over here. And you might be able to make out map preview. So my zoom tool brings us in. You see it kind of black and white here, so it's full HDR map. So where it's black, it won't emit a light. Where it's white, it will do. And so we can wrap this around. And you produce these if you want, simply in Photoshop or other such software, and bring it in. So I'll just simply drag and drop in to apply. First thing to change, obviously I've got the kind of background applied from that. That's not really what I'm after. So I'm going to jump back to my scenes, find the options, and untick a small tick box here called Show Environment Image. Untick that, I have a plain background, which you then can choose whichever colour I'm after. And in this case, I'll go back to white. Otherwise, what I'll quickly do here is spin around. So I'll move my geometry around. So using my Alt left click to rotate. Alt middle mouse button moves it around. Alt right, it is zoom in and you zoom out. And let's get it to a suitable looking camera angle. The other tip as well, now this is a control shift and left click, is you zoom to fit or look at your center upon. So center it on the screen afterwards. Now, for moments, we'll get some appearances applied from SOLIDWORKS. And we can see those in my Appearance tab and all over here. But what we can do instead is simply drag and drop from my library and apply a few more onto the geometry. So if I jump to my library, choose my appearances, and what I'm going to start with is paint. So if paint appearances are some of the best for getting your best reflections in, very simple, easy to control. And I'll go for some orange paint at the moment. And it just simply is a drag and drop. And the nice thing is, before I've let go of my mouse, it gives you a small preview of what it looks like with the orange. And so we just drag and drop, copying that onto the highlights of geometry. Now, a quick way of doing this is you can also copy and paste appearances if needs be. Again, it's going back to your keyboard shortcuts here, but hold down Shift and select an appearance with your left mouse button. Hold down Shift and do right mouse button, simply paste, and quickly, easily paste lots of appearances on geometry here. So a quicker method. You can see it's separated there by part. What I might quickly do is change it back to preview mode, just so benefit of you guys, so when it does change appearance, it does it a bit quicker. So I'll spin around here, again copy, and then paste on. All of these shortcuts can be found at the top. If you go to help, they're called hotkeys, or your F12 key brings them up. Our appearances I'll go for, so let's bring some white paint. So bring that onto my painted steel there. And go for wheel rim, like so. Now with the appearances, it applies each one separately. So if I scroll down here, back in my appearances again, you'll see multiple oranges and multiple white paint at this moment. What I can do quickly is bring them into one, amalgamate into one single appearance. Just a quick right click down here and use the option for Unify All Identical Appearances. Let's go back just one global one to control. And this way we can use a clever little option here. So let's say this can be a Solid Solutions branded trike. So what I'd like to do is actually change this to the Solid Solutions red. Now I could contact my marketing department, perhaps get the absolute correct RGB values for this. What I can do instead, I've got your tar this to the side, is simply choose my colour and use the pet tool. And this can pet from anything at all, so simply click and drag to red down there, and that is our value for the red. And if I change it to the RGB, see the exact colours I'm after. Got a thumbs up from Charlie from marketing department there, it's got it correct, so excellent. So a quick way, perhaps especially with concepts with clients, to use their colours really quick and easy and apply. It's a great way of doing it. Other appearances I'll bring on as well is perhaps I'll bring some chrome at the back over there. So I go back to my appearances in my libraries. And I'll find my chrome and just drag and drop it on and apply it down there. Useful thing to know, there are more appearances at the moment. I've got this small option turned on up here. So what it's actually doing is look at my local appearances rather than anything kind of globally on the internet. And if needs be, just a little globe here, which is from a different library, so I can download and apply different materials if needs be. And there's quite a lot of appearances at the moment here for it, and all built in, so no need to mess about with any kind of Modo sharing assets, as your photo viewer simply brought in straight away into the software. Excellent. So I'll just simply change this to my accurate mode, just see what's happening. And notice at the bottom my path is going up, and if I left this for longer and longer, it simply res up and do a better and better image for me. Little thing to note, if I zoom in down here, my zoom tool's not quite to what I'm after there. Here we go. At the moment I'm just looking at GPU only, so it's just rendering on my graphics card rather than my CPU. Why am I doing this? I'm doing this purely so I can run my applications in the background. It is very memory intensive software, so this allows me to look at my emails, do anything else in the background, running my CPU and let my graphics card render instead. You can do hybrid mode if you wish. Perhaps you want to do just a quick render. Somebody just puts all the power into one for you. I'm going to slightly more on my left here. You'll see the pass number. This is kind of locked, but it's going up gradually. So it's just almost 7 passes per second. It has various different levels. It's OK and good quality. Apparently it's 26 seconds that gets through OK. So I'll just quickly let that res up. It's up to about 500 or so passes at this stage. Excellent. Now let's look at using a render. So what we could do perhaps is simply let it res up on screen and save that out if needs be. And at the top, up here, we have our output tools. How I wanted to do that, I simply choose this option here, a small polaroid even, of a snapshot. I might simply save it out as I see it on the screen. Or if not, I can go to final render, which is a final render model itself. So final render options, what can we choose? So there's various options in our output mode. So I'm going to go through a full render. So that's JPEGs, PNGs, bitmaps, so your compressed image files. Or if not, you do a TIFF file, so uncompressed image file. Or straight into Photoshop as well if you want to do post-processing. Other things I can do, I can specify my resolution over here as well. Let me just zoom in. So at the moment it's doing 1920 by 1080. It's doing 300 dots per inch, so it'll be print quality for me. It's nice to actually have this value here to change in PhotoView. You can only do it at 96 dots per inch, and then simply have to change it in Photoshop afterwards. So it's quite nice to have this option straight away. In fact, it gives you a print size just below there as well. Going further down here, I've got my render option is accurate, so the best. And this gives me several options here for a drop down. So if needs be, I can specify a quality, so say X number of passes to finish. Or do a time limit. So perhaps if you know you've got a big meeting in 2 hours' time, so we could specify, okay, spend 2 hours precisely to render. So actually set that if needs be. And right the way down here as well, render device, how's it going to be rendered? So just in your processor, your CPU, just in your graphics card, GPU, or hybrid. So a bit of both, do it nice and quickly for it. Now rather than sitting here and doing the render, what I'll simply do is jump to one I've got done already. So let me just quickly change back to preview mode and go back to my PowerPoint. So there's my final output. I didn't spend too long rendering that, possibly about 15 minutes max. Got some nice shiny red there. Obviously the solid solution's red, it matches the red down there at the bottom of the slide. This is my custom appearance for it. And otherwise quite a quick and easy render, importing the geometry and producing this relatively quickly. So that really is lesson one, what we've covered. So I'll talk a little bit more about what else is covered in the course, whether that's for standard or professional courses. So we do cover decals, obviously, quite an important thing to bring in, appearance mapping, configurations, or really display states in Visualize, environments, your cameras, interior lighting, caustics, your post-processing options. So really when we get to this level here, your caustics and post-processing, that's really a professional area, that's where we're in. Then got your keyframe animation, your missing materials, or perhaps produce something as a light part, explode animations, walkthroughs, again professional items here, your motion blur, your turntable animations, your VR output, and your sun studies. And as we ran this last week internally for the first time, here's a few images produced from it. So at the top there we have a nice Porsche by the looks of it, and we have some ski goggles at the bottom there, so a few of the images produced on the course itself. We're quite excited about Visualize and quite excited about this course as well. It's a really nice tool, and some really nice renders from it and animations. And that is the webcast. Otherwise, that is lesson one, SOLIDWORKS Visualize. So I hope you enjoyed it, and I'll hand you back over to